Hello, hello, welcome folks. I'm so glad you could join us. Thank you so much for logging on with us tonight. We are gonna give it just a few more minutes to let everyone join us on the Zoom. And if you would like to go ahead and introduce yourself in the chat, you can go ahead and share your name and pronouns and your home congregation or wherever you're joining us from. Lynn, it's good to see you. We've got Kathy and Anne and Amariah. I wonder how many of the folks here were attended the introductory conversation we had a few weeks ago. All right, that's fine. Hello, welcome, Amariah from Columbus by way of Bowling Green. Lovely.
Amariah is Assistant Director of Ohio Council of Churches.
I see. Okay, great. You know, I read OCC and I thought, I'm not sure I know what that is, but thank you for clarifying.
Ohio Council of Churches. She is a magnificent human being, let me tell you.
Wonderful. So glad to have you with us. And Anne, welcome.
The check will be in the mail tomorrow.
Thank you.
Kathy Ross is here, member of West Shore UU Church in Rocky River. Lovely. I think we'll give it another minute or two. Let everyone get on and get situated. We are recording this session just as we recorded the first conversation. Only the things that happen in the big full group will be recorded, so you don't need to worry about anything that's shared in your breakouts. That'll be kept confidential. But we look forward to being able to share this with folks who weren't able to make it tonight. So if you know anyone who signed up but isn't here, we're counting on you to let them know how great it is. Yes, unfortunately, I can't take credit for this great playlist. This was put together by some deep canvassing friends of mine. but it's a wonderful set of music that we'll be listening to tonight. Welcome, Lynn, from Miami Valley UU Fellowship, Greater Dayton Area. That's also where I'm a member, so representing Dayton here. And of course, Pastor Hank, you know, for some reason I thought you were in Cleveland. Why did I think you were in Cleveland? You're in Columbus, huh? Anne is from Hopedale UU in Oxford, lovely. Well, it's 7:05, so if anyone else is gonna join, they're gonna have to catch up on the intros in the recording. Go ahead and stop our music here. And we can do some introductions. So again, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. Got a little bit of a smaller group, but that's fine. It'll be a nice intimate training and we'll get to spend a lot of time working on our skills. So I'd like to hand it over to my sort of co-host here to introduce himself, and then I'll share more about who I am.
Hi, everybody. Welcome. I'm Pastor Hank. My pronouns are he, him. I'm physically located in Columbus, director of UUJO. And I think for those of you who got the emails and came to our first conversation with LM on September 1st, we talked about deep canvassing and introduction to it. And we're going to dive a little bit deeper into that. I'm excited about this because I really think that we've got potential for not just engaging voters as we head up to election day, but also thinking about how we can use these skills that LM is going to teach us to really think about transforming ourselves and our lives and the folks around us in ways that that many of us feel that we need to do to really create some change for justice as we move into the future. So I'm super duper excited about this. LM is a fellow with UU The Vote. Very excited. I know she was excited to get the fellowship. I'm excited that she got the fellowship because we can have her with us doing this. So I'm going to turn it over to her and I'm going to listen and learn with the rest of y'all.
Thanks so much, Hank. Yes, hello. My name is LM. I use they or she pronouns. And in my sort of both my professional and personal life, I consider myself a community organizer. I've worked for several different political and community-based nonprofits. I also have an LLC, which allows me to do kind of side projects and consulting, specifically focusing on this deep canvassing work that I love so much. And it was late May or early June of this year when my minister, Reverend Kelly, sent forward an email about this UU The Vote Legacy Fellowship opportunity. And she just said, thinking of you with a little smiley face, and I didn't really know what it was, but the more I looked into it, I realized it was an incredible opportunity that UU The Vote has started just this year to provide young people and people of color with financial and professional support to do a project, to do whatever work it is that they want to do for their community. And I knew that I wanted to bring deep canvassing to my fellow UUs and to share these skills. So after writing this rather elaborate project proposal and reaching out to Pastor Hank to say, hey, do you think, like, would you be interested in doing this with me? I got it. I was awarded one of the first of six fellowships this year with other young folks and people of color across the country. So I'm the only fellow here in the Midwest, but it's been a wonderful experience so far to get to know the other folks and their work. And I'm so looking forward to being able to lead this training tonight and the follow-ups that will come from it. So as we get started, Hank, if you could go ahead and start the slide share with slide two, I wanna make sure that we're all on the same page about how to participate in a virtual training, how to use Zoom. It's kind of become the new normal here in the pandemic, but I always wanna make sure that everyone has a refresher on how to participate specifically in this training so that we can make it an engaging experience for everyone. So I invite you to write in the chat anytime if you have questions, comments, or reactions that you'd like to share with the group. And if you have any technical difficulties, you can specifically message me or Hank, or if you have any questions or uncertainties that you maybe don't want to share with the whole group, there is a private message option. You can also use the raise hand function if you'd like to share out loud any comments or reactions. And I'll be inviting us to do that several times throughout the training. I'll be inviting folks to come off mute and speak out loud to share their experiences and their opinions. The raise hand function, you'll see if you click the smiley face reaction button at the bottom of your screen, the raise hand and some other little reactions come up. So you're also invited to use those reactions at any time as you feel moved. But before we really get into the training itself, I'd like to I'd like to give us a few minutes to get to know each other a bit, get to know the other folks who are here with us. So we're going to do a quick get to know you breakout for some one-on-one introductions. This is also a very light warm-up for some of the deeper sharing that we'll do in these same pairs later on. So I'm going to open up breakout rooms in just a second, and each person will have about 2 minutes to share your name and pronouns if you like, where you're joining from, if you have a home congregation, and what brought you to this training, what you're hoping to come away with. I'll put that in the chat for you here. Oh, if I pressed enter. All right, so I'm going to open up those breakout rooms. You'll have about 4 minutes to introduce yourselves, and then we'll come back and get started. Welcome back. I realized that I wish I could have heard some of the reason folks joined and what you're hoping to get out of this training. If anyone would like to share what they shared with their partner in the chat, would really appreciate that. And we're going to move into the bulk of the training, which we'll start with slide 4. So if I can ask my trusty co-host to bring the slides back up. Oh, yep. Bring the slides back up on slide 4. Perfect. Thank you. All right. So I wanted to begin by explaining very basically, what is deep canvassing? Deep canvassing is an approach to having one-on-one conversations that's based on non-judgmental listening and sharing vulnerably from our own personal experiences. This is a large and growing field in organizing, and there are several different styles and approaches to deep canvassing. I personally was trained by folks who were really at the beginning of developing the tactic of deep canvassing. And that began in California after Proposition 8, which denied LGBTQ folks the right to marriage equality. What happened after that event was that a lot of local queer folks and allies wanted to understand what had happened and why that campaign that seemed so sure to win had actually failed. And so these organizers and volunteers, some of whom had never knocked a door before, went out and just started talking to people and listening and trying to understand their experiences and their perspectives. And that work evolved into this method of deep canvassing, which has since been used to actually change people's minds on a variety of political issues, including trans rights, including abortion, including immigration issues. And so this is in fact the only method that has actually been scientifically studied and proven to have a lasting impact on changing people's minds. There's a lot more information about the history of deep canvassing if you look up an organization called the New Conversation Initiative. I've got the link there on the slides, but I'll put it here in the chat as well. Newconvo.org is a great place to look and learn about more of the history of deep canvassing and how it's being used nowadays across the country. So if you'll go to the next slide, please. Some of you may have volunteered to canvass before for political candidates or campaigns. And deep canvassing is explicitly different from traditional canvassing. One of the number one reasons why deep canvassing is different is that deep canvassing does not involve sharing facts. There's no debating. That's very important. And the reason is that the reality is facts don't persuade people. When we are deep canvassing, we want to stay in the realm, we want to keep the conversation in the realm of lived personal experience, not even hypotheticals, but we really want to dig into what have voters actually lived, what are their own emotional stories and experiences, because that is actually how they will be moved, how they will be persuaded. And deep canvassing involves deep listening, which is not necessarily the same as active listening. So in these conversations, we're not having an equal exchange necessarily. The voter should be talking more than the canvasser. If you are deep canvassing someone, you should be doing much less talking than the other person. So deep listening is a part of that. It challenges us to recognize our own instinctual responses in a conversation, maybe the urge to respond or to agree or to jump in or to contradict, and our natural biases. again, yeah, we're not engaging in an equally two-way conversation. We are ideally guiding the other person through an experience. It's all about the voter in deep canvassing. And we don't necessarily go into these conversations with the mindset that we are going to persuade someone to think or act differently. The approach is that we're going to better understand the voter, their personal experiences, their concerns, and make space for them to process feelings that they might not have been given the space to process before. So if we are deep canvassing to persuade or move someone to change their viewpoint or to commit to voting, we don't actually persuade anyone. The voters really persuade themselves, but we can show them a way to make that happen. Next slide, please. So there's a couple core skills of deep canvassing, and these are specifically for deep canvassing for persuasion. First, absolutely that deep non-judgmental listening, it's huge. Second, curiosity. Curiosity is also the heart of deep canvassing, learning how to let go of your reactions and assumptions and ask questions instead. Vulnerable story sharing is something that we also need to practice. We are often asking voters to share vulnerably about their own experiences, and so we need to be able to model that and demonstrate that we are also willing to do so. And then finally, sometimes you need a little gentle assertiveness, which can be challenging, but it's necessary sometimes, and that's a kind of next level skill that that a lot of folks, again, need to practice, because these conversations are not like your average day-to-day conversation. So now that I've shared a very high-level overview of what deep canvassing is, I want to explain specifically how these skills can serve us in voter outreach. Next slide. So when we're talking about vulnerable story sharing, curiosity, non-judgmental listening, what we're really doing is we're inviting people into a deeper kind of relationship, even if it's just a 20-minute conversation at someone's door. The real power of deep canvassing to me is the long-term potential impact in inviting other people and inviting ourselves and each other into creating those deeper relationships with each other, within our communities, and with the communities we serve. Ideally, you know, if we begin to use these deep canvassing skills in our conversations and in our work, like I said, within our communities and outside, maybe outside of the walls of our own congregations, we can begin to shift towards something that's more transformational rather than transactional. And next slide. So specifically, I'm not able to make you all expert deep canvassers in a single 2-hour session. But what we can do today is we can practice leading with curiosity. We can practice how that feels. We can also get comfortable with telling our personal why I'm voting stories. Being able to tell your own story to someone can sometimes be just as impactful as them reflecting on their own experiences. If you don't have, you know, 15 or 20 minutes to have a full deep canvas conversation, but you've got 5 minutes to chat with someone as they're walking out of the grocery store, going into the library about voting, being able to tell a compelling personal story can have a huge impact. So ideally, we'll be able to practice these skills today and start applying them in our own conversations with voters and potential voters this fall. We do a quick time check. I think we're okay. next slide, please. So let's dig in on this deep listening. Could I ask someone to maybe come off mute and read the purple highlighted sentences there on the slide? Going to be a participatory training.
All righty, I'll read it.
Thank you.
Deep listening is a process of listening to learn. It requires the temporary suspension of judgment and a willingness to receive new information, whether pleasant, unpleasant, or neutral. Deep listening is not necessarily the same as active listening.
Thank you so much. Yes, repeating that point I made before, you may be familiar with active listening as an approach. And I want to kind of compare and contrast the nuances between these two things. Active listening might include paraphrasing or restating what someone has said in your own words. A similar but slightly different approach is mirroring or reflecting, which means literally restating what the other person has said, exactly how they said it, to clarify that you heard them correctly. So in active listening, if you're restating something in your own words, you are putting what you've heard through your own mind's kind of processor and spitting it back out. But if we're deep listening, we're not trying to process yet. We're really just listening. And so being able to repeat back exactly what someone has said can be really powerful for the other person to know that you've heard them. And sometimes when a person hears their own words back at them, they might start to rethink them. And so this can be especially helpful if someone makes a statement or shares an opinion that you're not quite sure about or not quite on board with. You can say, "Now, I'm pretty sure I heard you say da 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 da. Is that right?" And they may say yes, or they may say, "Well," and start to kind of change their own mind a bit. Another part of active listening is, you know, making affirmative statements like yes, uh-huh, absolutely, or those kind of noises or gestures. Those can also be helpful in deep listening as long as they remain non-judgmental. And this is something that can be really tough. Again, when you're talking with someone who maybe has a different perspective, you want to encourage them to keep sharing. And so you might say, mm-hmm, yeah, absolutely, right. But if they're saying things that you don't actually agree with, saying yes, absolutely right, might send the wrong message. And so I have some tips later on what you can say when maybe you're not sure what to say. Really the goal with this is that beyond listening, we want to encourage the voter to share more deeply and more vulnerably than they would in a conversation, than they typically would in a conversation with a stranger. And I'm gonna share another link for you, another resource here. If you're curious to dig more into the kind of philosophical and spiritual practice of deep listening, there's a really nice short article here that includes some meditative practices around deep listening. Next slide, please. Next one, I just skipped that. What does deep listening look like? In deep canvas conversations, our listening definitely includes reflecting back exactly what the other person has said. It may also, or it should definitely also include prompting them to say more, but just by saying, "Say more," or "Tell me more." Another very important tool that we have in our toolbox is silence. And this is something that can be difficult to practice at first. But honestly, sometimes space for silence is really what a voter needs to be able to process their own thoughts or take the leap to say something that they might have been hesitating to share. And Mariah says, one of my seminary professors used to always say in small groups, "Say more." Yes, great prompt, great neutral prompt. And then of course, asking open-ended questions is always good, which leads us to our next core skill. Next slide, please, drum roll, this is an exciting one. Curiosity. Curiosity is really the heart of deep canvassing. And again, it can be difficult to practice at first. It is a skill that you have to develop, but if you learn only one thing about deep canvassing today, it would be the power of curiosity. It can be challenging because it is different from what we're used to. It takes practice. It might even feel uncomfortable. But it is also powerful because it is different from what we're used to. And leading with curiosity and being able to ask those open-ended questions opens up the door to being able to have more authentic conversations and deeper relationships. Next slide. All right, so this is a classic deep canvassing tool, again, that was developed by my friends at the New Conversation Initiative, the cone of curiosity. So if you think about when you're having a conversation, with someone, if you ask them a question about their experience, you have to be listening. And there's a kind of big, wide kind of, if you think of the top of a funnel, that's what the top of this cone is. So you have to be listening for what might be the hint of an interesting personal experience. And that's when you say, tell me more. And you can ask for details. It's important to ask about those details. When, who was with you, to really get the voter to lean into that lived experience and for you to understand what it was like. And then one of the most powerful questions we can ask, if once we get a bit more focused down in that cone, in that funnel, is how did that feel? And well, I'll talk about feelings more. Feelings are an important part of our stories in deep canvassing, because if you remember me saying, facts don't persuade people, but emotions do, and their own emotional experiences do. And so if someone shares a story about an experience and you ask, you know, how did that feel? And they say, you know, I was afraid. That can be an incredible revelation for someone to name an emotion associated with an experience that they hadn't processed before. Or maybe it'll be a positive emotion. Maybe it'll be, you know, I felt so proud. And then the real bottom of the cone, the real diamond down there is asking why. Why did it feel like that? Because if we're asking someone their opinions about, say, a particular immigration policy, and maybe they feel angry that something seemed unfair to them, you can ask, if you ask why, they might not know. They might need time and space to process that. Or they might say, well, I just wish it didn't have to be that way. And boy, what a lead into an entirely different way of thinking about an issue that you couldn't have gotten to if you didn't spend the time asking those questions and narrowing down in on feelings and a person's experience. All right, so that was a lot. And I've talked at you a lot, and I've given you a lot of high level information on deep canvassing, and we're gonna get some time now to practice, but we're not gonna try and do everything at once. We are just going to practice our deep listening and curiosity. So we're going to go into breakouts again. But before we do, Hank and I are going to model this process. And Hank, if you could just go to the next slide, please. I'll explain the process, then we'll model, and then you'll get to practice. The process is one person, we'll call them the canvasser, will begin by asking the other person, we'll call them the voter, what do you remember about the first time you voted? Notice that this is not a yes or no question. This is an open-ended question. So the other person, the voter, will respond honestly with as much or as little detail as they feel is appropriate. The canvasser then can respond verbally, but only with additional questions. Say more counts as a question, but the challenge here is that you can reflect back what a person has said, or you can ask a question. And so we're going to really practice what leading with curiosity looks like in a conversation where one person is sharing and the other person is asking, and that's it. And definitely be yourself in these breakouts. You don't have to try to come up with some fantastical story or experience. Just be honest and share your real lived experiences. So Hank, you can stop the screen share, and we're gonna practice this a bit. Hank is gonna be a canvasser, and I'm gonna be a voter, and we're gonna see how this goes. I'll keep an eye on the time. We'll give us 3 minutes. You ready?
I think so.
All right.
So do you remember the first time you voted, or can you tell me about the first time you ever voted?
First time I voted. I honestly don't remember. I was always young for my grade, so I wasn't 18 until I had already graduated high school. So the first time I voted would have been the fall of my first year of college. So I don't honestly remember whether I voted like absentee or in Cleveland or in Mason. I really don't.
Well, I mean, do you remember anybody talking to you about voting, like before you were 18 or like after you were 18 in college? That kind
of
thing?
Yeah. Yeah. No, you know, it's interesting. I mean, my parents are pretty liberal and we're pretty like politically engaged. I remember like going to like protest George W. Bush in Mason once with my dad, and my brother was pretty like, you know, politically engaged when he was in college and I was in high school. And so I heard, you know, I heard about politics. I think for someone who wasn't old enough to vote yet, I was probably more politically aware or engaged than most people. Which is funny to me that like, I consider myself politically engaged, but I don't actually remember the first time I voted. I don't remember what it was about.
Yeah, I think that's okay. I mean, I have a hard time remembering what I ate for breakfast sometimes. But how about the most memorable time you voted? Is there a particular time you voted that like sticks out in your mind when you think about it?
Do you know, I got to vote for myself once because I ran for local office a few years ago when I lived in North Carolina. And, you know, I have voted in person the day of and voted early and voted absentee. I've voted various ways, but it's always fun to go in and actually kind of mark the ballot. I do like to do that. And I remember being in the ballot box that day, and there was my name on the list of candidates for Soil and Water Conservation District Supervisor. And I can't remember. I like wanted to pull out my phone and take a picture, but I know that's not allowed. And so I don't remember if I actually did. I could just download like a digital version of the ballot to show. But that was pretty cool because, you know, how often do you actually know someone that you're voting for? How often is it yourself?
Yeah. So.
Cone of curiosity.
Did that make you feel more engaged in the process or like a deeper understanding of why votes matter because you were on the ballot?
I think it was interesting. That was a really interesting experience running for office because it was really difficult. I earned a fair number of votes, but I did not win that race. And it was hard and it took money and resources that I barely had as a person who was just out of graduate school. And so I think when I saw my name on the ballot, I felt proud in a way that I had been able to do that. But I also felt kind of a little disappointed that I know how hard it is. And I know that it's not easy for the average person to actually run for something. All right, we're gonna cut there. Thank you, Pastor Hank, for doing that demonstration of curiosity and vulnerability with me. And now it is your turn. So you've seen it done, you know it's possible. I'm gonna open up breakouts in close to the same groups we had before. It looks like we've had a few new people join us. So let's see if I need to, I think the only folks who will be with someone new is Margaret and Michel will be together. And so if you want to take a minute to just introduce yourselves first, you can certainly do that. But for other folks, these breakouts will be open for 3 minutes. And you will be asking questions. If you're the canvasser, you'll be asking questions that whole time. Maybe we can bring up the slides once more to give folks the instructions. It'll be slide 15. The prompt is, what do you remember about the first time you voted? All right, here we go.
You're muted, Michael.
I am so sorry. I hit the breakout button, and I didn't mean to. I meant to move it, and I hit it. Cut her off. She was answering a great question. Margaret, my apologies.
That's all right. It happened.
I couldn't see her face, so I was moving the box, and I didn't do that right. Margaret, no worries, I would like to have heard the rest of your answer. I apologize for cutting myself off.
No worries. Oh, you can take the slide down, Hank, because we're not on break yet.
Oh, yeah.
Not yet. All right, welcome back, everyone. I'd love to do a little bit of debrief of how that went. My first question is for the folks who were the canvassers, folks who were asking questions. How did it feel to ask so many questions and to be kind of restricted to that? You can either type in the chat or raise your hand if you'd like to come off mute to share out loud. Michael, go ahead.
Well, I didn't get to ask too many. We did have a little question about when we're in breakouts, if you can see the transcription. And so there was a little bit of work on that briefly. And then otherwise, I think I asked two questions, but then I didn't hear the second answer. So that part's on me. But the answer, I mean, if we'd have had 5 minutes, I think I would have gotten allowed 3 or 4 questions in because of the flow of how it's going. So
sure.
I understand when you're at the door, you're going to be lucky if you get 3 minutes. So I get that and that in somebody's door. But nevertheless, I don't know how many questions you get. They're actually answering it and they're engaged. That's what Margaret had a great story about her first time voting and had a lot of context around it. So I didn't have to go deeper because she provided it. But somebody else might just say, oh, I did it when I was 18 and it was not a big deal. And then you just sit there. You know, I like a difference. But that's
well, thanks for sharing. You know, one of the doubts that I had when I first started deep canvassing was thinking, people aren't going to want to answer all these questions. People aren't going to talk to me. But one of the biggest surprises I found was that sometimes people really do want to share, or you ask a simple question and folks have a really incredible, great story to share that you wouldn't expect. So I'm glad that you at least had a little bit of that experience. Let's see, Anne says, I was curious about getting to know Kathy, so it was easy to come up with questions I really wanted to ask. Lovely, look at that. And this is, we are starting this in a much easier environment because we all have a little bit of something in common. So that's great to hear. And let's see, I'm curious, how far down in the cone of curiosity did anyone get? Did anyone ask how did that feel? I know we only had 3 minutes, so maybe you didn't get to that.
I didn't ask how it felt, but Kathy was talking about sometimes she would vote and other times she wouldn't. And so I asked, you know, well, when did she vote? What inspired her to vote? And so then we got to talking more about the context, the Vietnam War and Watergate. And so it wasn't a feeling question, but it was a question about motivation and better understanding when and why people vote. So that seemed good.
Yeah, thank you so much for sharing that. I mean, kudos to you for coming up with that follow-up question on the spot to be able to lead in, to go deeper and to actually learn more and kind of pull out more of Kathy's experience. Thank you for sharing. So now I'm curious. Uh-huh, go for
when,
it.
When, even though we didn't get down the cone, she kind of included the why in telling when she actually voted for the first time, which wasn't when she was eligible to vote.
Mm-hmm.
Going to college, she doesn't recall whether she actually voted at college. But the first time she voted was at a presidential election because the particular president is that who she wanted to repeat. And I asked the question, how did it feel? But then our time was up. So I didn't get an answer, but I did ask.
There you go. Well done. So I'm curious to hear now from folks who were on the other side of that conversation, who were getting asked these questions. How did it feel getting asked all those questions?
It didn't bother me in this situation, but if someone came to my door and started asking those questions, I would feel very uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm. And could you say more about why that would feel different for you?
I would be suspicious about anybody coming around asking questions.
Mm-hmm. I wonder where that suspicion comes from.
I don't know. Just recent, the recent situation in politics these days and what's going on in the country. Of course, I'm probably the oldest one here. Since the first time I voted for Ike. So that was a long time ago. And things have changed a lot since then. So I'm examining why I would feel so suspicious.
Yeah, well, I'm curious.
And I'm not a hugger or a sharing person with just everybody. So that makes a difference too. But I'm always surprised at how willing people are to talk and answer questions, you know, even strangers.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I really appreciate you sharing that and giving yourself that space for some reflection. I agree that our culture right now doesn't seem to encourage people getting to know each other and asking questions. And I wonder, you know, who does that serve when we are automatically suspicious of strangers? Sometimes that can be a matter of safety, depending on your identity or who you are or where you are. But something that I love about deep canvassing is that it challenges the fear of strangers. I was told by my grandma all the time growing up, don't talk to strangers. And I think I understand what she was trying to get at there, but I'm not sure don't talk to strangers is really the right message.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Margaret, thank you so much for sharing. Lynn has raised a hand. Go ahead.
I don't mind talking to strangers. I just don't want them asking me questions.
You want to be the canvasser. That's not, you know what? When I'm deep canvassing, I never have to answer any questions. I'm doing all the asking. So I hear you. Lynn, go ahead.
Oh, I can just answer briefly. You know, you asked how we felt when we were being asked. And because I'm like pretty active politically, and then when I was thinking back and thinking, I can't even remember if I voted for many of those elections when I was first eligible. And I felt bad about that, but not like on a level of deep emotion, like feeling terrible. It was more feeling to myself. And is it Amariah? Sorry if I'm not pronouncing it right. Amariah, she made me feel very comfortable. And I think maybe it was because of the neutral tone like you told us to use. And I think she did that. You know, I felt like her tone was just interested and, you know, interested and, but not judgmental, really, exactly what you put in the slide. So I didn't really feel bad in terms of uncomfortable with her. I just felt bad judging myself, you know, like, what? You didn't vote?
Interesting. So the maybe guilt that you were feeling didn't actually come from the other person, but it came internally. Thank you for sharing. All right, I wanna give you a chance to practice, a chance to switch roles and practice and have the other person ask the question. So I'm gonna open up those breakout rooms again. I know 3 minutes isn't enough time, but it'll just be a taste of that practice. And then we'll come back and have a little bit of a break before we start the second hour, the training. That is a good question. Welcome back, folks. We've got a new participant with us joining for the second hour, CQ. And CQ just asked a question about if you're having a conversation like this sort of out in the wild and someone's a real talker and they want to keep, they are going a little off course, how long do you let that go on? I don't have a hard and fast rule. I think when I'm deep canvassing, I'm usually trying to keep a thread in my mind of like, what is the experience this person is sharing? What is the personal experience they're talking about? Like, what is the story they're telling? And if their story is, if they've started to tell five different stories and haven't finished any, I'll go back and I'll pick the one and be like, you know, you mentioned this. Could you tell me more about that? And that's where the cone of curiosity is useful for like narrowing and like getting it into the guardrails again. one of the skills that we don't have time to practice today is that gentle assertiveness, in which I say, I grant you the power to interrupt. I grant you the power to take the reins in a conversation if you need to. So welcome back, folks. I'd love to hear from one or two people who were on the other side of deep listening and curiosity. How did it feel for you to be on the other side? Kathy, I think you're talking, but you're on mute.
Okay.
There you go.
So Anne spoke a lot about her experiences and her, you know, with voting. And I found myself the whole time trying to, she'd say something and I think, oh, I can ask her a question about that. And then she'd say something else. And it was hard to listen and then find a question to ask. So I struggled with that. And I did ask one question, but I don't think it was as relevant as it should have been. It was awkward for me.
Mm-hmm. I hear you. Thank you for sharing. And yes, that is, you hit the nail on the head there. When you're deeply listening, you're not necessarily thinking about what question you're going to ask next. And so it takes, some mental agility to get used to that. I also, you know, I think over the years that I've been doing this, I've built up a little like Rolodex in my head of questions that you can just turn to, or like, you know, start writing on a sticky note or in a journal, like questions you can ask, that if you just sort of like go in with some, not necessarily generic, but a set of questions you can always have kind of prepared, that can be useful, but it's one of those things that takes practice.
Well, Lynn must have loved my story because she came with some really good questions.
Really? What kind of questions?
I guess she heard my passion about why I vote. And I guess I kind of went to the why as well. But sharing that, first watching my parents vote.
Mm.
And we both realized that we were that generation that the amendment changed and allowed us to vote at 18. We were some of the first to get that in.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, when the amendment was ratified in 71, I got to vote for the first time in 72.
Wow, interesting.
Yes.
So was that an experience that you had in common with Lynn, of coming to age of that time?
Yeah. And as I said, you know, very rarely from 1972 to now, so we're talking 50 years, there might have been maybe two, maybe three elections that I did not vote. One was because I moved and forgot to change my voter registration. Or because election day was on Tuesday, I think one year I got stuck at work And at that time, we didn't have early voting and those kinds of things. And I was responsible for the payroll, and the payroll system crashed, and you couldn't leave till checks were cut. So the polls closed by the time I got done. But I mean, for reasons like that, maybe two times in 50 years have I not voted. So she asked, you know, was this something I felt really serious? And as I told her, you know, I was a child who watched the civil rights movement actually unfold. So I saw Bloody Sunday. I saw state troopers and Bull Connor with the dogs and stuff, attacking people who looked like me simply because they wanted to vote. And watching those experiences when I was old enough to vote has motivated me to keep doing it.
Thank you so much for
sharing. When you see people being deprived of it, when it comes to you, you develop an appreciation for what they did and what they went through to make it possible for me to do it. And it's a story I tell everybody, you know, and the issue for us back then was Vietnam, because the young advocates argued that if you could send 18-year-olds to go fight a war, they ought to be able to have a voice in electing the people who made that decision for.
Amariah, I think you've frozen on us a little. Okay, you're back.
I got knocked out a minute.
Yeah, I'm glad just you're back.
And it was Vietnam, that pushed us to push for the passage and the ratification of the amendment that lowered the voting age to 18.
Thank you so much for sharing that experience that you've had and the way you lived through so much of that history. I'm really excited to hear what story you'll share in the second half of this training when we come up to our current personal voting stories. I do want to take a little break right now, just 5 minutes, so that you can get some water, stretch your legs if you need to, and then we'll come right back and get into telling our personal stories. All right, hello, welcome back. Hank, if you could pull up our slides, specifically slide 19. Got a little bit more slide sharing here for our next practice. Just wanted to remind us again of our goals for today, to practice leading with curiosity, which we've done a bit of already, and then getting comfortable telling our personal why I'm voting stories. We also started doing this a little bit in our first set of breakouts, but we're going to dedicate the rest of the time to really refining voting stories that we can share with folks that we'll be talking to this fall. Next slide. And I want to go into a little more detail about why telling our own stories is important. For one, it demonstrates our own willingness to be vulnerable and to share. If you just start talking to a stranger and ask them to talk about a personal experience, they might be hesitant to share. But if you can share a little bit of one of your own personal experiences, it creates a bit more equity in the conversation and demonstrates what you're looking for, and invites the other person to basically give back what you have already given to them. And of course, when we share our stories, you never know what that might spark in someone else, whether they've had a similar experience or not. When you share an experience that you've had, something that you have felt, you might find an unexpected connection on a similar experience or emotions or values that the other person holds. How we tell our stories is important, and I'm going to give you even more guidelines here in a minute on how to tell an effective story. First of all, you want to be honest. And so I really appreciate the honesty that was shared from folks earlier in saying that, you know, I don't actually remember the first time I voted, or yeah, there's been times that I didn't vote. We're all complex, real people, and we change our minds. You know, your personal experience with elections and voting and our politics and democracy, I imagine has gone through many phases. And it's okay to be honest about that complexity if it's a crucial part of the experience that you're sharing. That said, you do want to be succinct. So we don't want to be the ones rambling at people when we want them to be sharing. Ideally, a good story is like just 2 minutes, maybe 3 minutes tops if you're a slower talker. So a lot of the work that I have to do in sharing stories is, you know, I write this great detailed elaborate story and then I have to cut it by like 75% because it's too much. And then a really important ingredient in every story that you share, you have to name a feeling. And again, this goes back to the fact that facts don't move people, but emotions do. And so again, when you name a feeling, it can open up the door for the other person to reflect on their own emotions and where those come from. And that might be the key to moving them on an issue or to moving them to take an action like voting. Next slide. So I am going to give us about 10 minutes here soon to practice to write out, however you feel comfortable, whether it's typing or physically writing, an answer to this question. Why is voting important to you right now? The story that I want you to practice is the story that answers this question. Why is voting important to you right now? If you'll go to the next slide, I'll pull out a key word here, which is why is voting important to you right now? Not why should voting be important to the other person, but why is voting important to you right now in your own personal experience? And one more slide. Why is voting important to you right now? We've heard some really moving experiences of the first times people voted or voting during really difficult and violent times in our country's history. Why is voting important to you right now? That's the story that I want to hear. And I've got a few more guidelines. We've got some examples actually first. Examples of a short story that might answer this prompt. I wonder, let's see. Would someone be willing to come off mute and read this story here? I promise it's not as long as it looks.
I'll do it.
Thank you.
I'm a lifelong Democrat, but this year my vote feels much more close to home. As a father, I'm frankly scared for the well-being of my daughters, whose rights to reproductive health care are under attack. Even though they're grown women now, I always want to protect and support them the best I can. But sometimes I'm not sure what I can do to keep them safe, and I hate that sense of helplessness. Voting for the people who have vowed to protect reproductive health care rights is at least one thing that is in my power.
Thank you, CQ. So that story didn't take more than a minute or two to share, but does it feel real? Do you see emotions or experiences in that story that you can relate to? It's certainly relevant to this moment. We've got one more example that's maybe a little different, so I'll ask for one more volunteer to share this story.
I can volunteer.
Thanks.
I haven't always voted in the past. To be honest, I usually just try to stay away from politics. But after this year's redistricting sham, I'm so angry about how horribly our state is gerrymandered. I've lived in Ohio my whole life, and I know it's not just a red state. Even if my vote can't tip the scales, I'm proud of my community, and I want to show the rest of the country that there are plenty of liberal voters here.
Again, we've got some emotions in there. We've got some anger, we've got some pride, and this might be a person who, as they say, isn't typically that politically engaged, but they've got something to prove. They've got a motivation. All right, yes. So next slide, this will show, this might feel like a lot of information, but I'm gonna walk through it. Just some guidelines for when you are writing your personal story. Again, it needs to be real, needs to be specific and personal. It does not need to be big or epic. We're not trying to win a contest here with our stories. We're just trying to be people. And it is important to paint a picture with details. Who is involved in the story? When? Where is it happening? And then, of course, key ingredient, how did it make you feel? Keep it concise, 2 to 3 minutes at most. Your story does not need to end with a moral or a point. We're not trying to teach here. We're really just trying to invite someone else to share and make that space to be honest with each other. It could end with a question like, you know, have you or someone you know experienced something like that? Or what does that bring up for you? Something that might invite someone into conversation. And I want to take a step back to reiterate a bit of the psychology, the science behind deep canvassing. You may be inclined when you're talking with voters to talk about the statistics and the kind of abstract urgency of this moment, but it is not, it is a myth that we make up our minds by weighing facts and information. Next slide. The reality is that our emotions make up our minds. And that's why it is so important to be real people and to share, to name our feelings and invite the other person to do the same thing. Because again, you can't really persuade someone necessarily. You can help them persuade themselves. I think there's that saying about a horse and water. all these emotions that we're constantly carrying, we don't always have time to unpack them and process them. So when you give someone that space, that's where the power of stories and deep canvassing lies. And we've got one more slide here. This is a thing that I love. It is a feelings wheel. It is a colorful illustration that just is full of words for emotions. And I'm gonna put a link to it in the chat. If you Google feelings wheel, lots of these come up. I particularly like this one. I like the spread of emotions it reveals. And again, even if your personal story and experience isn't relatable to someone, the emotion can be. And when we talk about using emotions, consider how the conservative right in this country uses the emotion of fear and anger to motivate people. They're really good at using base emotions to motivate people. They know that that works, and that's why they do it. And sometimes anger can also be a positive motivating force, but there's a whole rainbow of emotions here that we might try to lean into in our stories and our conversations to give people a different emotional motivation for thinking or behaving differently. Power of feelings. All right, so now I'm gonna give us about 10 minutes. I'm gonna play some background music. I'm gonna give us about 10 minutes to just brainstorm what your personal voting story might be. If you go to the next slide, I think it has the prompt there again, along with a couple of those tips. Ignore the time on there. That'll be return at 8:30. Whether it's in a notepad or typing on your computer or just in your head, I'm gonna give us 10 minutes to consider what story you would tell to answer this prompt of why voting is important to you right now. And then we're gonna have time afterwards to share our stories and give each other feedback. Oh, you know what, Hank, could you stop the screen share so I can get the music on here? Music, and I probably want more time to work on your stories, but this is just the beginning. Don't worry. We are going to, let's see. I think we're good on time. I'd love to hear from maybe just one or two people. How was that experience of trying to write your personal story? Come off mute as you feel called. Maybe folks are still writing.
Well, it was good for me because I tend to ramble on and have complex responses to questions, but I was able to write my story, I think, a good length in that time. So I was pleased for myself in that I could focus instead of rambling.
There we go. Thanks. Thanks for sharing. Yep, it's tough to make them concise. Michael, go ahead.
I appreciate all of it, she said and what you said about it, but I actually find it difficult to narrow anything down to my story because I'm prompted by different things. So what I wrote now, I actually was surprised about. I didn't expect it. I was born in 1960. I never thought about that way before, but there are examples put me in a mindset that went one direction. But if my students had asked me, or we were in a different kind of workshop about voting, I don't know. I feel like my story might have been this way. Not terribly different. It still would have been the essence of the feeling, which is, I feel like if I don't participate in the democratic process, I'm betraying those who went before me to fight for my right. It's like that simple. I know what's happening today is urgent, but to me, every election has felt urgent. I have never not felt urgency. This feels more than that, but they have all felt like you have to participate. Yeah, you know, you're turning your back on history. If this is how I feel, I'm saying about it. So I've never not felt that way. My family always talked about it that way. So I sort of always had that. But what if that's the closet, the clothes that I would hang on it might be different every day. And so just sitting here saying, what's my story? I'm a Libra. It's really hard to make a decision for me also. I always got, you know, this, that, and the other, and that. So in a second I can do it, but that's why I too, I share the rambling experience because you can see it right now and that. And so it is good to write it down, but it was a surprise to me that my story came out the way it did, but I feel like I'd have 16 others if I did it 16 more times.
Yes. Thank you. I'm so glad you shared that because you're absolutely right. Like, we're practicing writing a story. You can have lots of stories. We all have lots of stories, and taking the time to practice narrowing down is good for being prepared to have at least one story in your back pocket. But you can go through this process as many times as you want. And I also appreciate that you named some very clear feelings and emotions that you've had throughout different experiences. The context may be different, but the emotion is there, and that comes through very clearly. So thank you so much for sharing. I'm gonna send us out into pairs, breakouts again, but you should be with a different person than you've been with before. And what you're gonna do is take a few minutes, like 3 or 4 minutes, have one person share their story. And then the other person, the other person will give some feedback, and then you'll switch halfway through. And I'll try and send those reminders that you'll see at the top of the screen Thank you, Hank. There's the instructions. I'll try and send those reminders at the top of the screen to let you know when it's time to switch. If you are listening to someone's story, you can absolutely practice your curiosity. You know, ask some questions, ask some follow-ups. And when it comes time to give feedback, just be honest about what resonated with you. You know, what details stuck out? What was most memorable or emotional? Was anything confusing or unclear? Is there anything that you think, oh yeah, definitely say that? And we will do this practice here with each other to start to hone our stories. I'll open up those breakout rooms now. Welcome back. Yes, I know, never enough time. Whenever I get kicked out of a breakout room like that, it makes me think of Star Trek, like beam me up.
That's what I said. The first time I had to send people, we were doing vacation Bible school through Zoom, and I felt like Scotty beaming people up in the breakout rooms.
Yes, well, I hope that was a useful experience for you. We've got a little bit of time to kind of debrief and share what that was like before we wrap up. I'd love to hear, what was that experience like for you, either sharing your story or listening to someone else's story? How did it make you feel?
It impresses upon me as because you gave me Lynn again. You were supposed to be switching everybody up.
Oh, I guess no.
You forgot about us. Yeah, you gave me you put me and Lynn together again, but we were okay with it. I think that it is going to be the personal stories rather than spouting off talking points and propaganda. That's going to make the difference. That if the elections go a certain way, people are going to be personally affected by that. And if not us personally, our sons, our daughters, our nieces, our nephews, our grandchildren. And so if you are surrounded by family and friends, that ought, and to see what may happen to them in their lives, that ought to be reason enough.
Mm-hmm. And I want to ask you, Amariah, have you been doing any sort of like voter registration or get out the vote kind of phone calls?
Yes. Did you get out the vote? And I even work elections. I'm a poll worker.
Yay. Awesome. Thank you for that. I'm curious, how often in your get out the vote conversations do you talk about, do you ask a person about their family?
Very rarely, but it's something that I need to consider doing. Yes. And sharing it with my other get out the vote people. That it comes down to telling the stories.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And it can be as simple as asking, you know, are you a parent or are you a caregiver?
Yes. Yes.
That's a real easy question to ask that can lead to a really personal experience.
You know, yeah. And asking, you know, do you want somebody representing you who shows that they care nothing about you?
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing. I'd love to hear from maybe someone else. Was there anything that surprised you about this experience? Maybe something you heard or shared or thought of that you weren't expecting?
Go ahead, Margaret.
Oh, you're muted. Margaret, we can't hear you. You're on mute. There you go.
I was surprised that my partner's story was so much more in keeping with the deep canvassing concept than mine. My story was more factual, and hers, although they touched on the same thing, hers was more of a personal story that appealed to emotions than mine was. Mine was more, this is the way I am. Present the facts, think about it, make your decision. So I learned a lot tonight.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing.
But then when we talked more, Margaret, you got to some pretty strong feelings about being frustrated and kind of a understanding of one vote only being a drop in the bucket, but maybe it's the bucket that the drop that makes the bucket overflow. So for me, that exchange really helped develop both a point of common experience, common perspective, and a deeper story as we talked more, I thought.
Thanks for sharing. There's so much that I wanted to share and present and do in this, and we only had 2 hours, but maybe I'll just plant a little seed for next time, or for when you try and carry practicing these skills into your volunteer work. When we talk about voting and elections, that is just one part of our democracy. And I feel pretty strongly that when we talk to people about engaging in our democracy, we should talk about more than just voting. And I understand, like, I was one of those people in 2020 who I had to kind of be convinced to participate in that election, believe it or not. I was just so disillusioned with the way our federal politics had turned out. And one of the things that helped me decide to vote and that I share with other voters is that, you know, voting is not everything. And that's why I have these conversations. That's why I do other things besides voting. I think it's helpful to keep that in mind when you talk with someone who might share their frustration or disillusionment, or, you know, also a lot of folks have valid reasons not to trust our elections. They have been specifically, you know, their vote has been gerrymandered into practically nothing. Like, that's real. And so we can validate that experience while also inviting them into thinking about democracy in bigger terms. I'll also add that, you know, it's personal to me because my partner who's been coming in to bring me hot chocolate and cookies is not a citizen. He can't vote. So, and there are other people in my life who don't have the right to vote. So, you know, another maybe expanding of how we approach these conversations in this work is, you know, what does engaging in our democracy look like? Voting and or besides, in addition to voting. We're coming up on 9 o'clock, and I don't want to keep anyone past time. So I think I'll go into the kind of wrap up here. We do have some kind of next steps for you all, some resources that we'll send out. I just want to lift up that this thing that is called deep canvassing is one particular way of thinking about one particular name for using our curiosity and naming feelings and telling stories. And these are our countercultural kind of practices that come into play in many different kinds of transformational work. People who engage in restorative justice or other kinds of community organizing, ministry, are doing a lot of these same things. And so I happen to, you know, be passionate about deep canvassing. It's what I've done, but I recognize that there are so many ways to put these new ways of of thinking and being into practice in our everyday lives that aren't necessarily, you know, full-on strict deep canvassing. And the more that we practice these kind of different ways of engaging with one another, that is what leads us to the long-term transformation that this work can bring. I do want to give Hank a chance to say just a few words about, you know, that transformation and how it intersects maybe with our spirituality. Just be aware that we will follow up with you. You'll get an email with a story sharing worksheet that you can use to work on your stories. Keep an eye out for future trainings and conversations, and you know, put your curiosity and story sharing to use. I'll be curious to hear what comes of it. So thank you all so much, and I'll hand the mic off to Hank.
So I just want to again thank Eliam for approaching me about this from the beginning, even before she was awarded the fellowship. We started talking about it, and then after they were awarded the fellowship, then we started talking about how we can bring folks into this conversation. And I really, you know, LM, for better or worse, and thanks to their grace, listens to many sermons every time we talk, because this just kind of lights my pastoral fire when we talk about these kinds of transformational conversations. And so my hope is that this will help us, and I know what we've talked about tonight has helped me reframe the ways in which we can talk to folks about getting out the vote. But then understanding that we're building a toolkit for creating transformation after the vote. And it's not just about that. You know, as LM said, voting is just one part of the democratic engagement. And we know, we already know the lame duck session is not going to be fun after the election, because they're going to be pushing through all kinds of really heinous things. But it's going to offer opportunities for me and some other folks to have some conversations about how we feel. And I think I need to get more in touch with expressing how I feel and listening to people share with me how they feel, and honoring that and honoring those stories and experiences. And I think that that's where we build connection. And that's where we start mending that arc of history toward justice, as MLK said. And I shared with LM in a conversation. I was at a Honesty for Education Ohio rally a couple of weeks ago in Columbus. Dr. Hassan. Yeah, Amariah spoke. She ended us with a mini sermon that was fantastic. But one thing among many that resonated with me was Dr. Hassan Kwame Jeffries, from OSU, history professor, talked about the arc of justice. And we all know that from the arc of history, bending toward justice, that MLK talked about. But, you know, he was like, it doesn't bend on its own. We all have to pitch in and help bend it. And I think that this is another tool in our box that will help us bend it, but bend it in a way that connects us as human beings, right? Not just, hitting people with statistics. I shared with Michael in our last little breakout. I'm not a math person, but boy, do I love statistics. I used to get almanacs for Christmas every year because I loved reading. I know, CQ, I know. I would read almanacs as a kid, and I just loved reading through all of that stuff. But it really is about marrying that information with the deep connections. So thank you again for being here. Thank you to LM for bringing us together. I look forward to hearing from them more. We're hoping to offer a deep canvassing workshop and maybe a how do you feel after the election report at our fall assembly, which will be on November 19th. And there'll be an email going out about that. So I am really grateful for LM, what UU The Vote is doing, what they're doing with this, and look forward to deeper conversations and trainings. And I hope that you all found this beneficial. We'll be sending information out. This will be up on our YouTube channel so that you can share it with other folks as well and come back and take a look. Please like and subscribe to the YouTube channel. If we get 100 subscribers, I can change the URL to something that is UU Justice Ohio and not gibbledygook that YouTube gives us. So like and subscribe and look for stuff in your email. Thank you all so very much for being here. And I've taken us past the 9 o'clock hour, but thank you so much for your time. And LM, if do you have a last word to say? Okay.
Nope, that's it.
Thank you both.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you so much, everyone. Take care.
Be well. Bye.